Radio astronomy and black holes. No, I don't think anyone here is ready. Who here is ready to learn about radio astronomy and black holes? There we go. All right. Well, welcome to Astronomy on Tap, San Antonio. And this is only our second event post-COVID. So for those of you who were here last month, welcome. Raise your hand. All right. Welcome, newbies. Awesome. Cool. I'm going to hand Adam on sound. And our other hosts who help us prepare this, Michael Velez, he is not here today. So.
All right, yeah, so as Tracy says, we come here and text your questions at any moment during the talks. Posters, we have some casting, so. Yeah, awesome. So next slide, please, Tracy. Tonight we have two things about, I don't know if I say your name right, by the way, so. Okay. Jackie Champagne. We'll be talking about whose baseline is it anyway, and I love this title, by the way. Because when you do a radio interferometry baseline, have a break, astronomy in the news, and then we have a black hole talks from Dr. Richard Anantua. And I don't know if I say your name right. So, okay. So very excited about this talk also. And then there will be trivia at the end.
Baseline's covered.
Fun and interesting. Baseline, yeah. And oh, and there's also a keyword during each talks. So the speaker will tell you which keywords it is, and of course you can do whatever when the keyword is said, but we suggest drinking, you know.
So do you suggest that?
You have her bio?
Yeah, so I would like to, at this point, invite Jeff.
Yeah, so we'll switch for you, but the pointer works. It's
okay.
Just, it's too far away.
Where she will defend her PhD in radio astronomy 2 months from today. Can we get a round of applause for that? Massive black holes in the universe, which formed only a few hundred million years after the Big Bang. In her spare time, her favorite hobby is road tripping to every Bucky's friend. And with that, I will hand it over to Jackie.
Thank you, Christine. My expertise is in radio interferometry. So basically what I want to do tonight is set up why and how we were able to get a picture of a black hole. So you probably saw that in the news. And it's a really big deal for us to be able to see a black hole with our own eyes. And the engineering behind it. So take this ride with me. And yes.
One question.
Yes.
Yes.
So keep the word resolution in your head. I'm going to say it about 1,500 times. And every time I say it, go ahead and take a drink. Yeah. Ready. Okay. We can go ahead. All right. So warnings and disclaimers. If you are here for beautiful astrophotography, but that happens first, so just bear with me. You know, this is not beautiful pictures of the Orion Nebula. This is math. But that's okay. Good. I need a better signal, but yeah, I don't know. I'll just do a dance. Okay, so radio astronomy is typically done from the ground, which might seem, and that's because of the way the atmosphere works and what the atmosphere is made of. So there are a couple of lucky atmospheric windows where we can actually do astronomy. Obviously, there's the visible portion, but once you get into longer wavelengths in the infrared, we have issues with water vapor and other molecules that are in the atmosphere that absorb light. And so if you want to do infrared astronomy, we have things like, you know, the Spitzer Space Telescope. We now have the James Webb Space Telescope, which is going to be really exciting in a couple months. So yeah, at high frequencies, we have atmospheric opacity issues. And at low frequencies, you have quantum noise and you have Earth's ionosphere. But those things aren't really that important. So the good news is we can do radio astronomy on Earth. So up next. What's in the radio sky? Why on earth would we look at such a long wavelength that we can't see with our eyes? But there's lots of stuff going on in the radio. So our galaxy, the Milky Way, is bright in the radio. So we have something called synchrotron emission that is visible at a couple hundred megahertz. So this is basically to do with black holes are also bright in the radio, and it's easiest to see them there. When a star explodes at the end of its life, we say that it goes supernova. You can also see the shock wave in radio wavelengths. likes things like pulsars, which is a spinning star. So most people, when they hear that I do radio astronomy, they say, oh, like contact. And yes, exactly like contact. Unfortunately, yes, I have to give you that one. Contact is very scientifically accurate. And if aliens were going to contact us, yeah, they would probably do it in the radio. So is what are the elements that go into building a radio telescope? So bear with me just a sec. I got notes on this one because this one's hard. This is engineering. Sure, this has a Cassegrain focus. But there are other designs that you can use to build a radio telescope. So this here on the left is the rectangular aperture of the Horn antenna, which was the first instrument to see the 21-centimeter line. So this is a line that is then on the right here, we have Grote Reber's backyard radio telescope in Wheaton, Illinois. This parabolic reflector is about 10 meters in diameter. The original telescope is dismantled, and it was reassembled near the National Radio Astronomy Observatory Visitor Center in Green Bank, West Virginia. Unfortunately, the National Science Foundation actually decided that they didn't care about the Green Bank telescope anymore, so it's actually not placed in West Virginia, and see this thing. Not yet. One more thing. We got Carl Jansky, the father of modern radio astronomy, and his antenna that discovered cosmic radio static. It rotated in azimuth on four wheels scavenged from a Ford Model T, and an accurate replica of this is also located. It's drier than an interferometry textbook. Once we've decided what kind of shape we want to build our radio telescope, now we have to decide where to put it. And I talked a whole bunch of stuff about water vapor in the beginning, and that it turns out that's really important. So if you go outside on a really humid midnight and you notice that the stars are twinkling, that's not happening in real life, that's happening on Earth. That is on Earth. One is the Atacama Desert in Chile in the Andes Mountains, and the other is at the top of the volcanoes in Hawaii. So Mauna Kea and Mauna Loa are excellent sites to do radio astronomy, or really any astronomy. So you know, the Earth kind of picked those out for us. So now we've decided now. So there's a thing called the diffraction limit, and this basically determines how sharp of an image you can get. And this is related to the wavelength of light that you're looking at. And this is going to determine how here, oh, wait, this thing does something. There we go. This is a comparison of the different mirrors you need for really high resolution astronomy in other wavelengths. So the Hubble Space Telescope is a nice respectable size, and the Webb telescope has started to get a little bit messy because now we're starting to get to things that are much larger than people. So this, for instance, is the Green Bank telescope, I believe, up next to the Statue of Liberty. So this starts to get very, very difficult if you want really high resolution radio images. So what are we going to do? Well, we're gonna interfere, that's what we're gonna do. Okay, so next. Building things that are big and move is kind of hard. So we did try this a couple times. And the 300-foot telescope in Green Bank, West Virginia, once again, I would like to stress, the worst place on this in the background, quiet and desolate, and ready for aliens to contact us. So anyway, the point is that building a single-dish radio telescope gets hard. I'm not sure. I'm assuming it would have been in the 70s when we were upgrading. Data collapse, I'm sure it moved too fast. So moving on from there. Okay, so now we get to the magic of interferometry. What is interferometry? If you took a bunch of radio dishes and you pointed at things at the same time, basically, this is a complicated diagram showing two different radio telescopes. These are separated by a baseline. That is the distance on Earth that they are separated. And we are going to point to some astronomical source in the sky. This is the UV plane, and so we're going to correlate the signals to produce an image of the radio sky. So a bunch of electronics is going to happen here, and signals are going to get converted to electricity and then added, and a bunch of math is going to happen, and then you're going to get a black hole image. So, okay, who wants to do some integration today? No, that's okay. Next. forget about that. You need to go back. We're not going to do the math, but I will briefly explain. So we're taking visibility of the brightness function of the sky. So we are measuring the amplitude of an astronomical source. We're also measuring the phase or the position of the source. And so if you like math and you know about these things, if you have a point source and you take the Fourier transform, you get something like the Bessel function. or that's the Fourier transform of a disk, not a point source. So moving on. Okay, we're just gonna fake it till you make it. Why am I talking about this? What does this matter? The point is that that distance between your telescopes can function at the diffraction limit. So it is as if you built a disk very far away. So basically, we're just going to look at waves in the sky. And if you have two, then you get this nice interference pattern. But the more baselines you add, the more dishes that you add, the more we are averaging these fringe patterns, a Texas-sized radio telescope, which personally I think we should maybe consider doing, but maybe not right now. Right now we have this. Here's some stuff. Okay, so this is good at the same spot. And the more dishes we add, now we can see this 2D representation in the image plane of how these signals are becoming correlated and approaching this. It's great news for us because we are filling in the UV plane. We call this the UV coverage. The more spots from which you can hit the sky from different locations, the better UV coverage you have. And so now we're starting to get a nice resolved point source in the middle. And you get this lovely plot of, the Earth. Me, if I were hearing this for the first time, that maybe I could stick a telescope in California and another in Florida, and now I have discovered all of the radio sky, and now it's over. It's not that easy. Now we've got holes, so we've got to fill in the holes. So you need short baseline. So in order to recover all of the intrinsic properties of a radio source, first, you're going to want your short spacings. You want either a single dish telescope or telescopes that are very close together. And this is going to give us the general properties of our thing. So this is a guy. His name's not David. David Wilmot. I hate to say it. I don't want to sound ridiculous. I don't know who this man is. Okay? So don't worry about it. But we're going to go back. With our short baselines, we know he's got a hat on. We can't really make out much else, but we know he's there. And that's a really important thing that we do in radio astronomy is first we make sure it's there. And then once we know it's there, then we try to resolve it. So with your long baselines, now we are starting to be able to resolve cool details about this guy. So we know he's wearing glasses. We can see he's wearing a shirt from the Very Large Array because we're astronomers, not fashion models. And when you work at the Very Large Array, where else are you going to go but the Very Large Array store? And he's got a beard and all this stuff, but you're still missing those macro details. We don't really have a lot of information about where he's brighter or where he's fainter. So we need a bunch of radio telescopes, short and long, and just all over the place. We're gonna colonize the whole world with radio telescopes, and finally we get this perfectly resolved. Moving on. Okay, so that brings us to a black hole. The ultimate image is resolving the event horizon. So you have a black hole. Black hole is black, and then getting really hot, and it glows, and there's a disk, and that disk has a hole in the middle. It's a donut where the black hole is. So if you wanted to see a picture of a black hole, what you really want to see is the donut. And the event horizon is very, very short. It's only about, I don't know, I got it written down later. Yes, it is less than a day, and I will get to why that's important soon. So this isn't—we've got two black hole images now, but I'll get to why they're very different. So this over here is a simulation. About 20 years ago, a couple people were like, if we had a magic telescope and we could have infinitely good resolution, or not infinitely good, let's keep our expectations low, and what could we possibly engineer? How good of a black hole image could we get? And they simulated with very long baseline interferometry what it would look like to actually get an image of an accretion disk. And this was the best we could have hoped for. We kept our expectations low, and that's good. Even 10 years ago, this was about as good the resolution that we could get with long baseline interferometry. But in order to actually see that donut, we need millionths of an arc second of resolution. And this resolution, an arc second is 1/60th of an arc minute, which is 1/60th of a degree. And the moon, a full moon, is about half a degree. So that's how tiny we're talking about, which, as you can imagine, is very difficult. After all the math that we just had to go through, you have to be very careful with these signals, make sure you're not making stuff up. Moving on from there. So Now, this was really, really hard to do, and even harder than the one that we got in a neighboring galaxy about a year ago, and the reason is because of how fast it's moving, like you said. These signals that we're measuring from the sky, I said we're gonna let the Earth rotate around us, and we're just gonna, you know, wait for you know, the Santa Claus of the sky to rain down these lovely radio signals, and for a long time, it starts to matter if your black hole is going to move. And because the one at the center of our Milky Way is moving about every 30 minutes, this was even more of a headache for someone who's not me. But this is Sagittarius A star, and this is showing you some of the close we were able to get, and we can see the black hole in the middle. So this was taken with the Event Horizon Telescope, which maybe you're wondering, where is it? I'll tell you, it's all over the place. It's everywhere. The Event Horizon Telescope is a network of a bunch of telescopes around the world, and we combined our forces and made the best resolution. Oh, this is such a blurry image. They did all this work for this blurry image. Let me tell you something, okay? This resolution is the same. Okay, for a second, I need you to imagine that the Earth is flat. I know, like, okay. And it's Oktoberfest, and we're going to have a nice warm glass of beer because it's Germany. But just kidding, you can't have the beer in Munich. I actually poured it in New York City, and you're wondering, how on earth am I going to see that you poured me a beer? Well, if we use the Event Horizon Telescope, you could actually see the foam on that beer in New York City from Munich. That is how sharp this image is. I really did double check that. That is true. That is how good this image is. So no snark about it being blurry. So moving on. Okay, so this is all leading up to very long baseline interferometry, to get the spatial resolution to see the shadow of the black hole in M87. That was the first black hole image that we had. So this is ALMA. Actually, I liked it so much that I tattooed it on me. So I'm serious. Okay, so we needed every single baseline to actually resolve this image, and I'm going to show you an animation of how we were able to do that. So next up, about as good as we could do. If we click again, not that yet. Well, okay, well, we ruined the joke, and the joke was wrong baseline. But still a very good one. Okay, where's my animation, though? There might be a little video. Maybe if you click there might be a play button that pops up. Uh-oh. Okay, well, Jerry Seinfeld has come to say hello, to ruin my jokes, as he is wont to do. Please, this is the most important part of this talk. Oh my goodness. Is this little Earth image is gonna move. So we are collecting data as the Earth rotates, and we're also adding more and more baselines, and we're gonna watch this thing turn into a donut, maybe. Well, I'm sorry to disappoint. Well, what's going to happen is, much like the picture of the mystery man, this will turn into more and more spectacular detail, and when we combine the combined forces of telescopes from a second off, it's complete garbage. And so that's really the fun of radio astronomy. That's why it takes so long to get a PhD, is because you could just miss a decimal point somewhere, and somehow the next guy will probably show you a nicer image. So we can just move on. I've come to tell you about my master plan. If I were to go to Congress and say, please give me all the money in the world to build my dream telescope, I want to put one on the moon, or one in low Earth orbit. If we were to do that, we could improve the resolution of the Event Horizon. Any ideas, though? I don't want him putting anything in there. Starlink has already ruined our images. Forget about it, okay? No more satellites. But I do want a radio telescope up there. So I think we've got one more slide. Okay, hopefully this one will animate. If we were to put a radio telescope in low Earth orbit, this is what would happen. Okay, well, we're doing simulations. So just imagine. Okay, so revealing the magic, putting everything back together. So the reason radio interferometry is magic, the reason why this works, is a testament to all of the things that humanity has figured out about science and physics throughout history. We needed to have figured out that a parabolic dish can focus waves and that we could collect light that way. Light behaves like a wave. Light can be a particle, light can also be a wave. The fact that we are able to take advantage of the wave nature of light is what makes radio interferometry work. Because light travels at a finite speed, we can track distances, basically, a difference in space. And that's real, because some guy named Fourier, chilling in France, was like, hey guys, I got an idea. And no one else ever had that idea again. And then electronics has to work too. To be able to correlate these voltage signals is the only way that we can actually add up all of this like random data, basically, that's coming into these telescopes. And to be able to transform all of that to take this total mess of electronic numbers and turn it into an image of the sky, an image that we cannot see with our eyes, we can see the entire radio universe from here to all the way back to the Big Bang, from the tiniest things to the biggest things in the universe. We can map out our entire galaxy, and we can see little tiny black holes. So it's really amazing. So that's really basically it. I wish I could have shown you my animations, but you know, whatever. It is what it is. So thank you for listening to me.
Fantastic talk. Thank you so much. Sorry, the animation didn't work. I guess the...
Oh, I learned all this in interferometry school in Hawaii, where there was a blizzard, so much for the water vapor comment.
So guys, if you have any questions, you can text over here. I have a question myself.
Yes.
So has the event horizon...
But then they got together and they were like, hey guys, what if we started adding stuff up together? The only reason you would need resolution this good is to resolve individual objects. But for instance, ALMA, my very favorite telescope in the entire world, has been used to see quasars at the Big Bang, the disks around forming planets. No, it wasn't. I don't know if it ever was, because Arecibo is a single dish, but also Arecibo collapsed. So that was really sad. There was an earthquake in Puerto Rico, and it went bye-bye. So.
How would having a telescope outside of the atmosphere help gather information in the UV range for a better image?
Yes. So basically you are able to get the longest base up to low Earth orbit would get you a very long baseline. You'd still have holes in the middle, though. So if you needed to collect all the light, you just have it orbit a lot. And there you go. The end.
All right. If you could fly in any Star Wars spacecraft, it was the previous event. Wrong. A telescope the size of Texas on Earth, or put a radio telescope into low Earth orbit?
Whoa. I would have to say that the moon one would be my favorite. Imagine that baseline from here to the moon.
Big question. Why is it called UV if it's a radio interferometer?
Oh goodness. Wait, which part? The UV part?
The UV, ultraviolet.
Oh yeah, that confuses lots of people. See, I think in very long wavelengths, anyone says UV to me, I don't know, what is that? The sun, I guess. No, U to L and M, which is latitude and meridian. So it's basically a way to get from Earth coordinates to space coordinates. If you were thinking ultraviolet, simply forget it.
Cool. And then, what was the resolution of Sagittarius A star image compared to M87?
Ooh, I don't know off the top of my head, and I bet our next they were about the same, I think.
Mm.
But even though the one in the Milky Way is much closer, it's much more complicated to image because it's moving a lot. Oh, I'll tell you. Is it radio quiet? It's awful. I can't have the internet there. So one last thing about when you're choosing where to put your radio, and you can't have a lot of Wi-Fi or TV satellites or anything like that. So they're typically put in very desolate, remote locations. And most of West Virginia is part of the National Radio Quiet Zone. So there's nothing. Once you're driving there, the GPS cuts out about 2 hours out. You have to print out the directions from Google Maps. We're just going to pretend it's 2000. We're going to print out from MapQuest, Jesus billboards, and then finally the telescope. It was very lonely.
How many times have you been there?
Twice, and that was two times too many. It was way cooler to visit the submillimeter array in Hawaii. At least I got a free trip to Hawaii. Come on.
right here. So it's really awesome. Thank you so much,
thank
Jackie.
Thank you so much for having
Make
me.
Make some noise for her. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, I give this to someone else. Do you want to come take this from me?
All right, I think we're going to take a short break. Oh, yeah, you have something?
No, I'm just holding the mic for her.
Thank
apparently.
You so much, yeah.
You can have this too.
Thank you.
Yeah, so we're going to have a short break. Don't forget to tip your bartender if you want to grab more beer, food, anything, you know, and we're going to be back in 5 to 10 minutes. So thank you, guys. swags here. We have like beautiful stickers, beer glasses that are really beautiful, with Astronomy on Tap logo. We have bottle openers, and we have lot of cool stuff. So you can either play the trivia at the end to win them, or you can actually shirts and more beer glasses. So next we have the Astronomy in the News that will be done by Caleb Guimard, part of the Astronomy, UTSA Astronomy Group, right? So yeah, tell us everything about what's going on in the sky soon.
Let me get the remote here. Is this a remote?
Yeah.
That's a remote? Okay. It doesn't work? Okay. I can't use the pointer? Okay. Okay, yeah, that's fine, all right. Oh, here's the Astronomy News Roundup for this evening. Go ahead to the next slide, please. So first and foremost, if you go out in the morning sky right now, you will still be able to see planets. They are a little more separated, though, than what they have been over the past couple of months. So if you look over toward the east, just at that about 5:30 a.m., below the great square of Pegasus in the sky, and you will find Jupiter and Mars. Not easy to mistake Mars in the sky. I mean, it has that very deep red color. So, hey, you know, very, very easy to see. And then after that, you will find Saturn, which is actually a little more centrally placed in the sky. It's more toward the south there. But nonetheless, you will find them all in a row there. The thing you do have to keep in mind about them, please. All right, so the general sky for June in the evening puts many of the springtime constellations front and center, but some of the summer stuff is starting to rise. So always remember, find the Big Dipper first, follow the arc of the Dipper to the bright red-orange star Arcturus, then spike down to Spica, a nice blue-white star there in the sky. There are two actually look like little fuzzy spots within these areas of the sky. So if you find the constellation of Hercules, this little polygon-shaped thing here, in between those two stars, you will find the Hercules globular star cluster, which is about 23,000 light years away, give or take a bit, contains about a million stars. And then if you look down way low in the south here, getting a really nice dark nighttime sky, beautiful sight, it contains about 10 million stars and is about 17,000 light years away. So in the news recently, there has been a development on Uranus and color than Neptune does. Well, using data from the Gemini North Telescope, a group of astronomers has run some simulations, and there might actually be a solution to this color difference. It may be that Uranus has a layer of haze in its atmosphere that Neptune does not, therefore giving Uranus the paler color. So very, very interesting. This was just announced yesterday as a point of fact. Go ahead with the next slide. And then just a little bit longer ago, probably about a couple weeks ago, a news story came out regarding measurements of the Hubble constant. This is the expansion rate of the universe. So a number of years ago, it's probably about two decades ago now, it was determined that the expansion rate of the universe accelerating in its expansion. So this measurement has been taken again with the Hubble Space Telescope for the local universe. And this group, which was actually led by the astronomer Adam Race, who was one of the co-winners of the Nobel Prize for the original expansion universe, it's usually predicted around 6 to 7.5 kilometers per second per megaparsec. Why? Well, we kind of use this blanket term called this dark energy thing there that's causing the acceleration, but we have yet to really figure out what that dark energy is. Next slide, please. Presentations. The solar eclipse is coming up in 2023 and 2024. The 23 one is an annular eclipse, which you still need glasses, the solar eclipse glasses, to really see appropriately. And the total eclipse, which is at the area of the sun, you can see the outer atmosphere of the sun, otherwise known as the corona, that streaking area there. And that concludes Astronomy News. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Caleb. Awesome. Awesome talk, yeah. And we'll keep reminding you about this, those eclipses coming up, because we're in the front seat here in San Antonio. So the two talks that are already lined up. One will be about the solar wind interaction with Earth from Dr. Michael Starkey. And then we're gonna have Robert Reeves, who actually is sitting here in the front seat, who actually took this picture The Rosette Nebula, right? Yes, from San Antonio downtown, so like Terra Hill. So incredible, and he's going to tell us everything at how he does that, his techniques and his equipment. So come next month, and yeah, it will be awesome.
Okay, next up we have Dr. Richard Anantua.
Yeah.
Okay, from UTSA. Dr. Anantua recently moved from a postdoctoral position at Harvard to start the first Event Horizon Telescope recount for current and future observations of polarized emission around black holes, including M87 and Sagittarius A asterisk. He also led the EHT outreach group, coordinating with international press officers to publicize EHT science, curating EHT social media, and linking EHT with diverse organizations. So let's give it up for Dr. Richard Anantua.
Thank you. Yeah, so this time around, since we have one, but since the clicker is just going to be my telling the person who is running it to click forward, you can use click if you want. All right, so you can use either or both, Horizon or click. What you're seeing here is a population of black hole shadows. So it's a rapidly growing population, so it took pretty much the entire duration of human civilization until 2019 to come out with this image, you know, this glazed donut. Once you get the sprinkles on the donut, which is the polarization directions of the magnetized plasma that's around this black hole that's being lensed into this ring. And then this population grows really fast, so we got another one in 2022. So if you were hearing anything in the news about this, there was actually a number of press conferences on May 12th that had talked. I'm going to be going over some of what I and the rest of collaboration think might be governing some of the plasma physics that appears the way it does with these ring-like structures. So click if you want. So first, we can get some terminology out of the way. An active galactic nucleus that's often surrounded by an accretion disk of inflowing matter. So in this source, you can see that there's some inflowing matter around here where all the action is, so very deep, strong gravitational potential that's drawing in all this magnetized plasma. Sometimes the magnetized plasma wants to go in, sometimes it pushes back against itself, MAD, because they like acronyms. And these magnetically arrested disks are in contrast to disks that have plasma just freely flowing into the central supermassive black hole. We also have Stokes parameters that describe polarization, which you can think of as filters that only allow certain orientation of light to approach your polarization directions, which we like to call Q and U, not to be confused with U and V, which the previous speaker eloquently talked about in radio interferometry. We just like sampling throughout the alphabet. And then there's whatever polarization is left is circular. Click. In this cartoon, you'll actually see that because the gravity around black holes that rotate drags space and time around in a phenomenon we call frame dragging. It's a completely relativistic effect. Newton wouldn't have drawn this diagram this way. You'd actually have magnetic field lines that are vertical and are close enough to particles, say, through the synchrotron radiation process that a previous speaker, Champagne, had spoken about. And this particular jet, actually my advisor, Roger Blanford, is one of the eponyms of the type of jet that you see here, where it's the black hole that's... there's also other ways that particles can acquire energy. For instance, you can have chaotic fluid motion that we intuitively call turbulence, create turbulent heating that can impart energy onto particles in this type of inflow-outflow structure. So let's go to the next slide. And my acronym, since, you know, everyone has to have one. I'm going to be using a method. You use general relativistic, you know, these phenomena that Einstein were predicting where gravity is strong, can curve space and time. you use general relativistic magnetohydrodynamics that describes the astrophysical plasma as a fluid, but that's affected by these space-time effects, the variables that you're getting from this, these simulations. You can add on how particles radiate in this curved background space-time. So they radiate, they're polarized, they are accelerated by those mechanisms that I was talking about. And now, when we have this light from this process, we can finally observe the simulation or semi-analytic model. So the next, you can actually see this in action with a few event horizon telescope sources, like the M87 black hole, which is actually the prototypical jet with a central supermassive black hole. That was the first image that we took. And you can also see it in our own galactic sensor, Sagittarius A star, which supermassive black hole. So let's actually go into one of these systems. And one click. And at 12 hours in right ascension and 13 degrees in declination lies the Virgo, which is our best studied cluster of galaxy, the Virgo cluster. And it also has the black hole with the second largest angular width in the sky to our own, in our galactic center. But this one is called the Curious Straight Ray, because in 1918, Curtis only saw this large-scale jet. But we have seen now the jet at all wavelengths and scales, all the way down to the innermost black hole shadow, which we now see in polarized light due to the Event Horizon Telescope. So, please click. So, Ms. Champagne told us last time, we use these very long baseline interferometric arrays in order to, you could be seeing foam bubbles in Munich from here, or you could be reading newspapers in Canada from here. You actually need the entire width of the Earth in order to give you that type of resolution. So, go next. So, once again, M87 is a giant elliptical galaxy in the Virgo cluster about 54 million light years away. And, you know, light years is the distance that that light travels in a year in a vacuum. So, it will take light only about an eighth of a second to get around the circumference of the Earth. So. Different wavelengths. And, you can see more and more of the larger scale jet until you see the galactic lobe at the scale of a very large array. You're comparing long wavelengths, like 90 centimeter radio, all the way down to 230 gigahertz or sub-millimeter very long baseline interferometry to get from these 10,000 parsec scales all the way down. So, you have a very large range of scales that you see M87, and you go next. We've actually previously measured, before we can directly image it, through Carl Gebhardt at UT actually, came out with one of the stellar dynamical measurements of 6.5 billion solar masses for the black hole in M87. And Event Horizon Telescope only got, this has actually been a longstanding controversy in the literature where there was a gas dynamical measurement that was about half of this value. But now we're able to discern this with error bars. It's like 10% at the 10% level. So this is one way that can actually be resolved by our imaging. So we can go and see more of what we can do in next. So, all right. Once again, we can also look at the polarization, and if you can see some of these tick marks, they show that on a 1,000-ish light year. Scales of the ALMA telescope, you're able to see a large-scale jet, and you're able to see some magnetic structure within the scales of these knots. You can go in, and you can actually see at 43 gigahertz, very long baseline array scales, that you actually see some turbulence indicated by the orient preferentially polarized in. And when you get down to the Event Horizon Telescope scale, you actually see a very distinct southern Brighton polarization pattern that's roughly spiral. And this spiral pattern of electric vector polarization actually corresponds to vertical magnetic fields that are parallel to the axis of the black hole if it's rotating that magnetic fields. Next. So and now to understand some of this using simulations, that part of the observing JAB simulations methodology where we actually turn the plasma variables like plasma beta, which is the gas to magnetic pressure ratio. We can turn these plasma variables. Electrons are typically thought to be the emitting particles in the simulations, as you see in the simulation library. And the electrons are radiating synchrotron radiation, and the ions tend to be cold. And you can parameterize where electrons and ions are hot or cold as a function of this gas to magnetic pressure ratio in a parameterization such as this. So low value of Ti, or T ion over T electron. So the electrons dominate the temperature where you're dominated by magnetic pressure. And at high values of the plasma beta, think of the accretion disk on the equatorial plane, you have the ion temperature dominating where the ratio tends towards R high. So putting this in action, we can use a simulation library where we change R high from 1 to 20 to 1. We change the simulation accretion mode from maximally retrograde, so minus 0.94. These are units that go from minus 1 is completely retrograde and plus 1 is completely retrograde to zero spin to, this time extreme spin but prograde. And you do this for the same two, so retrograde, zero spin, and prograde. And what you end up seeing is that simulations that have higher magnitudes of these spins, matter near the black hole that's actually rotating, in fact, towards your line of sight, the part that's rotating towards the line of sight actually has a relativistic effect that beams it and makes it brighter. So if you have a relativistic emitter that appears, first in its own frame at rest, you'd think it would be isotropic, but if it starts moving close to the speed of light, it actually starts looking like a flashlight. And if you have matter that's beaming towards you because of the rotation of the black hole, you start to see it look lopsided. So you have a relativistic effect, and you also have an effect on the polarization patterns that distinguishes the magnetically arrested disks, which the MADS on the left tends to have spiral electrovector polarization angle patterns, and then the ones on the right tend to have more radial electric vector polarization angle patterns about in the magnetically arrested disk case. So in this magnetically arrested disk case, you have these fields that can source the jet, but in the standard and normal evolution case, you actually have weak and azimuthally symmetric magnetic field patterns. So for standard normal evolution, which is the right half, the magnetic fields tend to just go with the flow. They tend to be azimuthally symmetric because the electrovector polarization angle pattern is radial, plasma flow, and doesn't affect it and stand up to it like the magnetically arrested disk case. So this actually tends to favor the magnetically arrested disk in terms of how we can explain what the inflowing matter is near the accreting black holes that appear to be lopsided. So next slide, please. And we can probe it even further by using simulation. So we make some assumptions about it's the thickness of the disk that's inflowing, whether it's magnetically arrested or standard normal evolution. You can make assumptions about the spin of the black hole, and then using the treatment of astrophysical plasma as a fluid, but also with these funny Greek indices that talk about space-time variables. So it indexes a time-like variable like the zero, and then it runs all the way to 0, 1, 2, 3, which the 1, 2, and 3 were the space-like variables. So now you're in relativity. You can have a red-ish or more dense inflow with magnetic fields that ends up sourcing vertical magnetic fields with low density or blue plasma that's coming out, and you can create these jets with these types of general relativistic magnetodynamic setups. The unit of length here is the gravitational radius. So for a black hole with the size of the one in M87, the gravitational radius is about some order 10 to the 12 or 10 to the 13 meter here. And you actually can have light travel 9 hours across the gravitational radius of this big black hole. So now we got the scales and we have the picture of the flow. Okay, you can go further, click. Now we can actually do the next part of the radiative transfer. The next part of the observing jets. Radiative transfer, we actually have these functions that are so-called emissivity functions that you can integrate up to your line of sight. And whatever is contained in the emissivity function But here I'm going to make a model where I'm just going to relate this emissivity to the pressure of the relativistic emitters. In this case, we just think of them as electrons that are synchrotron radiating. And I'm also going to relate it to the current density, J. So if I have a model for radiative transfer with this type of emissivity, current density model, I can have, you know, I'm going to let you guess which one's the model, which one's the observation. I even put it in the title, so it's not that hard. You have those flailing return currents that are bounded by the higher density plasma outside. But if you look at the observation on the right, you'll see these somewhat flailing layers of possibly current heated or possibly otherwise heated. But you see some of these boundary layers also in that observation. It's more of a sheath in the observation. But you also see some of the poor brightened emission where you get very close to the unresolvable dense and optically thick core, but then you also see some of the features in the boundary layers in this current density model. So that's arrested disk versus standard and normal evolution. And if you add in positrons to brighten this source, you can actually compare this when you have different quantities of positrons in there. So when you play this movie, I'm adding positrons, you know, a few percent at a time until they're equal in number density to the original number density of electron pairs. So, you know, for the first simulation, when you add the positrons in, go back a couple. Yeah, the degree of circular polarization goes down by a factor of 3 electrons. You'll actually cancel out the emission from half of the original electrons. And you end up having a third of the overall degree of polarization due to cancellations with the circular polarization of the positrons. It doesn't really decrease monotonically like it did here when you add positrons. And the electric vector polarization angles just flip wildly when they didn't flip at all in this case. So the positrons actually have a pronounced effect in the standard normal evolution polarized case because the depth of this plasma that's responsible for this flux quantities or like that we summarize as Faraday coefficients. The depth of this plasma percentage of Faraday depth to these Faraday effects when the Faraday depth is much bigger here, like thousands rather than a few or tens here, you can actually get 1,000 times more rotation of these electric vector polarization angles when you add a certain percentage of positrons. Statically arrested disk would be given positron effects with an instrument like the Event Horizon Telescope. So we can go further. Now let's go to our next source, Sagittarius A star. So we have a galaxy that is a little less than 100 kiloparsecs in diameter, and we have around 100 billion stars in this galaxy, maybe 200, 300, 400 billion, give or take. And when we go through these, one of these is our sun. It's about 8 kiloparsecs from the center of the galaxy. But when we get closer and closer to the center of the galaxy, we actually start to get to the innermost parsec of this galaxy, of this 100 kiloparsec galaxy, the innermost stars. If you think about the UCLA group, had the Nobel Prize winner Andrea Ghez, that pioneered this work, you actually see some of the very, very near orbits around what we didn't know was a black hole, but we had very strong circumstantial evidence was a black hole. But now if you click, we're now able to see, you can see this by the very large infrared telescopes led by Reinhard Genzel, also a Nobel winner, from Galactic Center, and go to the next slide. And also argues a phase-on orientation for the accreting matter in the innermost few gravitational radii near the black hole, which is what we've seen with the Event Horizon Telescope. Go ahead. So, again, let's just click a few times. So, there's a lot of stuff in the galactic plane. So if we're trying to see something here and we're situated here, we're gonna have a challenging task to do that. That's one of the reasons why it took so darn long to get the image out of the galactic center in our own galaxy rather than the image from M87, even though we took data from them in the same 2017 data set in Sagittarius A star. And we are likely dealing with a radiatively inefficient outflow where the accreting matter accretes highly sub-Eddington, And its luminosity is extremely low. It's one of the lowest luminosity sources relative to, you decide whether a star is just going to blow up due to radiation pressure or if it's going to collapse. So this is very sub-Eddington accretion, and it's also very sub-Eddington luminosity. So this is a pretty, you know, interesting source that we're dealing with right in our own galaxy. Continue. So now, luckily, we had this very Gaussians or Bessel functions, if you can see the lighter outlines, correspond to images. And the Event Horizon Telescope back in 2008 was more of a proto-Event Horizon Telescope array. It's hard to define what an Event Horizon Telescope is when it's comprised of telescopes all over the world that keeps sharpening. You can think of it as some sort of emergent property of greater and greater resolution depending on what source you're thinking of. But back in these days, we can make inferences already about the size of the, use the basics, the yeah, I'm sorry, this, yeah. Anyway, you can use the size and the width of the properties of these UV plane flux density versus baseline or visibility amplitude plots, convert them into characteristic sizes of the actual XY plane images, and we then later on realize that, you know, it's figures such as these if you add in the extra complexity from more data. So now let's see what we can do to actually interpret what's going on in that region. Continue. So we finally had enough time to process the data and reconstruct it using several different pipelines in order to, so-called clean algorithm, take some of this very, very wavy and messy low-resolution data and turn it into pictures of whoever that person with the hat and the logo of the observatory was. So that's what we've done now with our own galactic center black test images that we've received from these algorithms, and we've seen that they cluster very naturally into ring shapes. So almost all of the images that we did with all of our pipelines, with all of the different assumptions, look like rings of 50 microarc seconds. And we also note that the bright spots in the ring, each of the different clusters that the images in all this parameter space ended up, and you can see that there's a very small population of these, like, roughly double source, the hottest. And then we now have this image, which is an average of these method averaged and these cluster averaged images, turning into the composite best bet that we have for what we think the galactic center black hole looks like. All right, continue. So, sorry, don't show this. Next. Sorry, that was actually the next generation of Event Horizon Telescope. So we can try to start understanding what goes on at the level of plasma physics in these types of simulations. So this time we have a little bit of a more complicated simulation. So click. So at this point, you're probably too dense. You know, this rho's density, a dense equatorial inflow, but then you have this polar outflow near the jet axis that's underdense, but it has the higher magnetic fields and it has the lower plasma beta. And you can model electron temperatures that are just the electron contribution to the gas to magnetic pressure ratio that is in some of the models where I'm considering conversion of magnetic to particle energy. So go next. So this is a space of these basic types of heating that I described, the turbulent heating models basically put the higher electron temperature in the lower betas and the lower electron temperatures in the higher betas or the equatorial regions in these vertical slices these are the turbulent heating models that are beta dependent. These are different classes of models that are basically feeding the emitting electrons from the magnetic pressure. There's high magnetic pressure both in the disk and in the jet, but there's also just very low density in the jet. And you can see, just using the same simulation, changing these electron heating properties when you're viewing this edge-on, it actually looks very, very, very different when you have this edge-on configuration, but you also increase the beta where the transition from electron to ion heating occurs at the higher betas. You can also decrease the electron beta in these magnetic to particle energy conversion models to also replicate some sort of somewhat degenerate looking crescent shape. And these smaller images tend to be proven by the observations. But we already seen the observations tend to have the face-on orientation. So this is a low angle towards the spin axis. So in these face-on simulations, you see a lot less of those heating models tends to favor these for being the best conforming models to what we know from observations. Next and penultimate slide. So going to compare the gravity collaborations infrared in the slices at the right versus the infrared horizon telescope, and changing the orientation from looking at it completely edge-on, where you have these highly asymmetric patterns, spots, and we actually are starting to agree more with the face-on orientation. So I'm going to leave with the conclusions. Click, click, click. So in conclusion, we have, for the first time, seen actual horizon intersecting features in black holes. So the direct imaging of the plasmas using observing jet accretion flow black hole simulations as a methodology to link the phenomenological processes like turbulent heating to the energy of particles that are emitting radiation. We see in M87, which has been observed at large distances, but has this strong dynamically important magnetic field close to the horizon that's actually feeding the black hole with this vertical flux. And then we see that the simulations can be distinguished between mad and sane using the polarization effects that you see, especially with positrons. And you also see the Sagittarius A star that you see hot spots. All right, I'll leave it you with questions.
Thank you so much. Yeah, great talk. Thank you. If you have any black hole question, now is the chance of a lifetime. You have a world expert in front of you. So I got a question. What will the Event Horizon Telescope observe next?
Yeah, so these happen to be the easiest targets. So they have these, 50 microarc second diameter rings, and get the next horizons, maybe Centaurus A. There are some Markarians that have very, orders of magnitude or order of magnitude smaller shadow sizes based on their distance and the size of the object. So we are going to help us fill in some of these gaps that we've seen in the visibility space. And we're also potentially going to be going to space. So maybe the dream of getting this space-based antennae in 5 years to see tens more black holes in our little solar system worth of black holes. And we'll be able to do some real statistics on those.
Yeah, that was one of the other question. Like right now, we cannot improve the EHT staying on Earth because we already have the longest baseline.
We can add more to help to bring telescopes out in space.
So another question more from me, when you observe with a telescope, you're always competing with other fields. So now you have two pictures of black hole and you guys have done a lot of work. Like, is there a push for having more time for observing black holes?
It's not a zero-sum game. I think it's the more we, as a scientific field starts to grow. So, if this is what you like, then maybe at some point in the distant future, a politician will actually mention science in their campaign speeches.
Yeah.
But I think it's up to us to make it our priority. And we can all get what we want. What we all want.
Yeah, just another question. Can you explain why we are not seeing Sagittarius A star edge on? Because this person would have expected the rotation axis to be to the black hole to be aligned with the galactic axis.
The vast majority of us have expected that. It actually seems that, for the most part, the disk of accreting matter whose plane we're on is, it has one large scale orientation that doesn't change, and so you get very close to the black hole. And I mean, we've seen some of these by the frame dragging of the black hole. It seems like the black hole's gravity, very close to the black hole, can, we're talking about small fractions, 10,000ths or 100,000ths or millions. Like a billionth of the diameter of the galaxy, we actually start to see the effects of the black hole dominate the immediately surrounding accretion flow. So it seems like the black hole,
saw some planets have rings that are all sorts of different orientations, like Uranus,
almost as if the black hole is.
Okay, cool. In one of the like the blob that we see around the accretion disk, is there a chance that when you get more resolution, this could be like a star being swallowed, or there's no chance a star would like be survives that close from the black hole?
Yeah, so actually that could be a question for my the postdoc Brandon Kurt, who's coming here and studying tidal disruption events at University of Texas at San Antonio. So he's finishing his PhD at Harvard, and he's actually studying what happens when you have a tidally a little closer to the black hole than further from the black hole, and actually might contribute to what we call super Eddington accretion. And maybe tidal disruption events have a particular signature that we can see in the simulation of black holes.
How many individual radio telescope observation or images were acquired to make the Sagittarius A star image, and how long did it take to?
And we have thousands of different instances of the imaging pipeline running from those different techniques, and we just blindly reconstruct in a way that we don't really talk to each other until we see what the end product is. And then we basically come to narrow down the space of possible images very greatly. And after thousands of instances of, it's very likely a ring, and it's very likely a ring with these three bright spots distributed around somehow.
Cool. And last question, I got a lot more questions, but I guess if you guys have any more questions, you can come and see Richard afterwards, and I'm sure he'll be happy to answer them. Can this study help us, in the future, how we power life and future energy needs?
I mean, depending on how far in the future you're willing to wait, I mean, maybe in five. As you know, these sources are very far. So the closest supermassive black hole to us, it would take light 24,000 years to get. And where our propulsion can only take massive things, very, less than 1,000th at the speed of the speed of light, quite a bit less than 1,000 years of light. So we have to get very creative with the technology if we're to bridge these distances. Or maybe this is a problem for quantum physicists or quantum field theorists. Probably would either have to invent a new branch of physics or really, really accelerate the progress of technology and also make sure we don't annihilate each other before discovering the stuff in order to really be able to get anywhere near these black holes.
Okay. Thank you so much. Make some noise for Dr. Richard.
Would you guys believe us if we told you we didn't originally planned to have a perfect alignment of learning about radio interferometry and then the discovery? We really had two incredible talks tonight, so let's give it up again for both.
Thank you so
Jackie
much,
Jackie Champagne and Dr. Richard Anantua. It was awesome. Okay, now we go. So, as per tradition, we will now move into our astronomy trivia. If you have a PhD in astronomy, you can't play. So you can hang out, whatever, but don't give any answers. No cell phones, but we have a couple. Vincent or Christine are going to come around with the pieces of paper for y'all to fill out. Oh, Vincent's got them back there.
Does he need help?
Probably. Learned tonight so far. Because you're going to learn a little bit more during trivia, probably. Anybody? Anybody? What's it? The wide array of telescopes creating one big telescope. I agree. That's pretty cool. Any others? I'll say this question didn't get asked. Vincent chose to ignore my questions. But Dr. Anantua, I had a question for you. How intense is the, is there an intense radiation field affiliated with the magnetic? What is it?
We measure intensities. We measure these intensities in Jansky. So think about tenths of Janskys or a few Jansky. I mean, Janskys to watts, I think you're going to need some sort of 10 to the 26th. They're very, astronomy specific units, but if you
think about field of view that we're looking at, you're going to see some a few Janskis worth, and think about a conversion factor of 10 to the 26 with SI units of astrophysical intensity between Janskis and like whatever you need, like watts and hertz and seconds, square meters, etc.
So like the radiation will kill you if you're out there, or no?
You'd be killed by so many different things out there. It's almost like that's...
Somebody who wants to play trivia need a thing to write with.
A utensil.
Several of
a
you.
A utensil.
A writing utensil. Okay, keep your hands up. Vincent is going to come around.
Okay.
We got like two more in the back. Okay, we have one pencil also. Oh, it's broken. Never mind.
I have a pencil from when I voted the other day. Hold on.
Yeah. Excellent. Good job, Tracy.
I got one. It's here. Who wants my voting pencil?
Okay, everybody go. No, we have one more. One more. Two more. We're going to buy some pencils for the next one.
All right. Robert, do you need a trivia card? Or do you want to join like a team?
Trivia.
Okay. Question one. How many times larger in mass than the sun is the black hole, aka Sagittarius A star, at the center of the Milky Way? Is it 1 million times larger than the mass of the sun? 2 million times larger than the mass of the sun? 3 million times larger than the mass of the sun? 4 million times masser than the sun? Or 5 million times more massive than the sun? Next question.
We should get like the Jeopardy music to play in the background for these next time. Which of these were not discovered using the first pulsar, C3, I don't know why I started numbering them, Jupiter's powerful magnetic field, a D, the echo of the Big Bang, AKA the cosmic microwave background? Markers. Where are the markers? What?
Not trademarked. We're not copying.
Go ahead, Ben.
Next slide. This is me. Question three. Which is the largest steerable radio telescope in the world? A, the Arecibo Observatory in Puerto Rico, the 500-meter aperture spherical telescope, aka FAST, in China, the Green Bay Telescope, which we heard is a lovely place to visit, telescope in Russia. Steerable telescope.
Right,
singular? Steerable. Then you can choose that answer, okay, if you so choose.
A large array is a telescope. Oh, we're going to get in trouble on this one.
Next.
Question four. What is the scientific term used to describe how an object, or even a person, be... the riptide effect, C, vacuumification, D, the singularity paradox, or E, the space-time continuum?
I will take credit for this question, personally.
I thought they were good.
Next slide. Question five, interferometry, which you should all be experts on at this point, is a technique that combines detections from multiple radio telescopes using the what mathematical formula? Laplace transform or E, sum of squares? Nobody knew they were coming into a math test today. Next slide.
Question six. Black holes are so named because they have a force of gravity so strong. Theories. One, A, the photoelectric effect. B, not two, B, special relativity. C, general relativity. D, wave particle duality. Or E, energy mass equivalent.
And last slide for the bonus question. Remember, there are some really incredible posters up here for grabs, so make sure you're taking trivia seriously. Bonus question is, theoretically, what is the size of the smallest black hole that could exist? Is it A, the size of an atom, B, the size of the Earth, C, the size of Jupiter, or D, the size of... Okay, we're going to award a fake
honorary
Astronomy on Tap PhD to the winner of this. You also get a lovely poster, but you can frame your PhD instead. Okay, when you're ready, you can bring up your question cards up to the front. Make sure to tip your awesome hosts here in the meantime. Oh, you have to put a name at the top.
Did you guys put a name?
Oh, okay.
We're missing.
Put a group name at the top.
Get questions. Question one. The black hole at the center of the galaxy is about 4 million times the mass of our sun. It's very large, it's very big. Question two, the expansion of the universe was not discovered. Telescope in our favorite state in the US, West Virginia, is the largest steerable radio telescope, singular, in the world. It's do you see an S at the end of telescope?
It says, well, the VLA is a radio telescope.
Correct.
As a whole, it's the largest steerable array.
I would say it's an array made of multiple radio telescopes. Loosen up a little bit. That's how I feel. Question four. The scientific term to describe to use how an object or person would be tidally torn apart by a black hole is A, spaghettification. Question five. Interferometry is a technique that combines detections from multiple And question six. Black holes are named because they have a force of gravity so strong that light cannot escape. This was correctly predicted by Einstein's theory of C, general relativity. Question seven, the bonus, the smallest black hole you could theoretically have is A, the size of an atom. Maybe black hole. Okay. I'm gonna be waiting for Vincent to come help with that.
All right.
Oh.
Oh yeah, cool.
Prize,
That's awesome.
Nice.
Check, check.
Oh.
In the first place, we have the team Robert R. Sir, with almost a perfect score.
It is a perfect score. Because the VLA is the largest steerable telescope. Jack,
come on up. Do you think the VLA is a telescope?
Yeah, it's like saying the world's biggest.
You got this.
Y'all won. She says it's
this beautiful poster of the moon. Oh, it's your territory, the moon. Yeah, we remember this beautiful talk you gave with a lot of stickers, and so congratulations.
And this mug and a Blue Star cup that Joey donated.
Okay, well,
congrats.
Yes. Winning co-hosts over here. Thank you very much.
Second place, we have also this beautiful cup given functions. Congratulations, guys. Beautiful poster again. And we have some really awesome stickers of the Europa mission that will go to Europe. That sounds cool.
Yeah.
And then third place, we have 3-person tying. So we have the Marvel. We have Hugh Janus and Ramirez Colange. Kira Rock. I'm sorry, I'm destroying the name. So you guys come on here. We have some. So yeah, three teams. We have the Hugh Janus, Ramirez, and Marvel. All right, and the Marvels are, I remember. And this is for you. Yeah, thank you again. Thanks for everybody for coming. That was an awesome presentation. Thanks for the presenters. Thank you, Jackie. And make some notes for Jackie and for Richard. Thank you, guys. Yeah.